Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Marcus Aurelius, and this is Dwarf Fortress 2014 Anvilquested. And looky here, folks, looky here. A vile force of darkness has arrived to assault our fortress, our Anvilquested. There are many things we need to do to prepare for this invasion, but before we do so, I would like to profile some dwarves. Now, this episode, it's not going to be a random profile. I've actually picked two dwarves out. They are named after friends of mine, Alpha Blades and Elena. They are the friendly moderators of Tokshin's Twitch stream. So when he's not doing YouTube videos, he's doing a Twitch stream, and Elena and Alpha are his moderators. So I decided to just thank them for their hard work as moderators of that channel and just being really cool people in general by focusing on their dwarves in this episode. So that's what I'm going to do. While we're under siege. So there you have it. Let's see here. Starting with Elena. Elena is married to Alpha Blades, and Infinite is her younger brother. Byzantine is her uncle, and Lilu Multipass is her niece. Quacksalver is her nephew, Jan is her nephew, and so is Kivish, who is just one of our dwarven children. Torgar Hammerstriker is her cousin. And Stephanos is her cousin. And of course, she's on friendly terms with a number of our citizens. Doesn't have any grudges with anyone, so that's really cool. Elena Starbreeze Okoshmorul has been happy lately. She has been satisfied at work lately. She ate a wonderful dish lately. She admired a fine seat lately. She's married to Alpha Blades and has one child. Oh, wow. Zan Throtgranite. Okay, cool. Didn't know that. She's 83 years old, born in the 11th of Hematite in the year of 69. She is broad and fat. Oh, no. Her copper eyes are deeply sunken. Her nose bridge is incredibly concave. Her teeth are tangled. Her nose is broad. Her hair is clean shaven. She has... Well, I hope her hair is clean. Oh, I mean, she's bald. Oh, wow. She has a broad chin. Her hair is chestnut with a touch of gray. Her skin is copper. She is indefatigable, but she is flimsy and susceptible to disease. She likes stibnite. I don't even know what that is. Rose gold, star sapphire, musk ox leather, Kenoff plant fiber fabric, or Kenoff and plant fiber fabric, gems, bracelets, flasks, and Gila monsters for their venomous bite. When possible, she prefers to consume giant bushmaster, rainbow trout, water buffalo cheese, apple cider, and blood amaranth leaves. I wish the punctuation was better on this. She absolutely detests toads. She has an amazing spatial sense, a feel for music, and a good intellect, but she has poor memory, little linguistic ability, and a large deficit of willpower. She personally values artwork, values decorum, dignity, and proper behavior, and sees competition as wasteful and silly. She dreams of mastering a skill. And then we have Alpha Blades. Alpha Blades, of course, is married to Elena. K54 is his aunt. The Fundorf is his uncle. Torgar Hammerstriker is his uncle. The Etruscan is his cousin. Kragger Kveltcharn is his cousin. And he's on friendly terms with a number of folks. And that's it. No grudges. Wow, they're both very friendly people. Alpha Blades and Doc Samore has been happy lately. He dined in a legendary dining room recently. He admired a fine door lately. He has complained of the lack of dining tables lately. There are so many dining tables. I don't know how many dining tables these dwarves want. He is married to Elena Starbreeze, Vigor Paged. That's what her name means in English. and has one child. He is 63 years old, born on the 24th of Sandstone, and he also was born in the year 69, or 83 years old. He is thin and scrawny. His eyes are copper. His long sideburns are braided. His very long mustache is neatly combed. His very long beard is arranged in double braids. His very long hair is braided. He has high cheekbones, and he has an angular chin. His head is extraordinarily broad. His nose bridge is somewhat concave. His slightly flattened ears have small lobes. His hair is chestnut with a touch of gray. His skin is copper. He is weak, susceptible to disease, and very quick to tire, so Alpha is not going to be joining the military, unfortunately. He likes bituminous coal, aluminum, red diamond, spotted woebegong leather, interesting, coral, jute plant fiber fabric, the color russet, bucklers, backpacks, barrels, ballista parts, and he likes the letter B, apparently, cavies for their three toes, and ocelot men for their coat patterns. Well, that's one thing we have not been attacked yet by, is ocelot men. When possible, he prefers to consume giant narwhal hake, custard apple cider, or just giant narwhal in general, hake separately, custard apple cider, and rice flour. He absolutely detests moon snails. Maybe he's gluten intolerant, I don't know. He has willpower, but he has poor focus and poor creativity. He personally prefers a noisy, bustling life to boring days without activity, and doesn't really see the point of working hard. He dreams of raising a family. Well, that's sweet, Alpha, and you are raising a family with your little child, Zan. I'm gonna have to do something about that. Is Zan at the fortress? No, Zan. So, you left your baby somewhere else? That doesn't seem like very good parenting, in my opinion. But that appears to be the situation here, unless I'm missing something. Can we not? Yeah, dwarven child, dwarven child, dwarven child. Litast is a dwarven baby. And that's the child of Good Bad Dwarf and Dwarf Comics. So, I guess you left your baby somewhere else. Alright, well. So it goes. Alright, well, first thing we need to do now, in order to prepare ourselves for this invasion, is we have to get our burrow going. So that's W? No, it's not W. It's M. And then it's Alerts A. And Danger is our civilian burrow. Okay, perfect. So now all of our civilians are going to run into the fortress. I haven't updated the burrow, so there's some areas that they're not going to be able to get to, but that's okay. Every place they need to get to, they can get to. Next, I need to go up here and close two of these, at least, for right now. Oh, I think I already have two closed. Yeah, I do. So we're going to have to close this one before the goblins get here. But prior to that, we need to make sure... Oops. We need to make sure our people who are down here get in there safe. So we have... Who do we have out here? We have Blunderbuss. And that's it? Okay, Blunderbuss. Can you save yourself, please, sir? Okay, Blunderbuss is in. This is closed. Oh, and you know what? Before we continue further, let me introduce you to all of our new guys, because there are new ones. So, of course, you've already been introduced to Alpha Blades and Elena Starbreeze, but it was also Blecto Begum, Grumzub, Leonard Yeldra, Nidoros, Samsi Cacrenios, Cacrionis, Steingrim, Tection, Adrian, Ash, Bry 7x7x7, Lady Awesomeness, Malinor, Panda Bear, The Mr. Me, Tinfoil Cookies, and Torgar Hammerstriker. Elena actually has some military skill. Not a ton of it, but a little bit. Her and Tection. The Mr. Me has 3 Mace Dwarf, so I made him a soldier trainee. Not sold yet on Elena or Tection, but why not? They do have some military skill. No. Some military skill, even if it is not excessive military skill. And they're both ladies, which is fine. I'm not too worried about it, but They intend to carry their babies into battle with them, although neither of these two... Well, Elena has a baby, it's just somewhere else at the moment. We'll have to find out in Legends Viewer where that baby is, the poor thing. Okay, back to the siege then. Welcome to all our newcomers. Alright, so what's expected to happen is that the goblins down here will make a beeline for our entrance, and they're going to kill our poor... Well, it's no longer a puppy, at least. It is now a stray dog. Of which we have many, as you shall see. Look at all those dogs, and look at all those poults. I mean, could you imagine walking in that room? It must be horrific. And we have crap everywhere. Like, we have worms and louses. Although we do have... There's Carol, who's a kitten. And we have a few other cats. So we should be getting that problem under control. I've kind of fixed up our stockpiles a bit, as you can see here. We now have a stockpile just for bins, just for barrels, and just for minecarts and wheelbarrows. Minecarts, you may say, Marcus. Why do you have minecarts? Well, let me show you. I have completely reworked our entire stockpile system to utilize a skill I learned from some other YouTube videos, as well as someone named Mechanics, or something like that, on Reddit. Called a minecart quantum stockpile, and it's very similar in concept to the quantum stockpile that I have here as a dump, except it uses a minecart. So how it works basically is you make a small stockpile for the item that you want. So let's do my stone example. This is chert, this is phyllite, and this is mica, the three types of stone so far that I've found in this fortress. So in each one of these I have one wheelbarrow and six overall places. So the dwarfs will go out with the wheelbarrow and they'll pick up some chert or mica or phyllite and they'll bring it here. Then what happens is there's a minecart here, and this minecart is programmed, which is very complicated and I'm not going to explain it, but you can, if you're curious, you could find out on Reddit. It's programmed to have the dwarves take items from this stockpile, put it in the minecart, which it then dumps onto this stockpile here. Underneath this is a stockpile one by one. So if you go over to this, you will see that all this chert is in this stockpile. So it's basically a huge pile of chert over here, huge pile of phyllite over here, a relatively smaller pile of mica, and a willow log for some reason that I am not quite sure of. I have two more down here for wood, one for hematite and magnetite here. And what's cool about this is you don't have to use bins, so you can see what you're doing. Like, for example, you can tell this is a gem, and all of my gems are going here. This is leather, all my leather's going here. Cloth, thread, bone. And I've also done it down here for my bolts, which is great, because the dwarves have trouble getting bolts out of bins. So now that I've done this, they have a lot more bolts, and as a result, they're practice shooting a lot more. Which is good for me, because now I need them to get ready to kill goblins. So let's set that up. Squads. Gordosh's gorillas will have you at the top. And that will do move there. And then Bumchafe's bandits will be at the bottom. So we'll have you moving there. Alright. So we should see them start moving. Oh, and I started mining up here just to get more ore. Up, and there they come. There they come. Okay. So my soldiers are doing what they need to do. The question is, are the goblins? It looks like they are. So what do we have? A very small amount. We have a pikeman, two pikemen, a lasher. We have one crossbowman. And a hammer, axe, mace, a axe, a bowman. So a bowman and a crossbowman, but neither are elite, so we shouldn't have any trouble with them. They're not moving very fast. I expect I would get better FPS than this. Whoa, what just happened? Oh, Blood Rune. Yes, Blood Rune died. This was not unexpected. Blood Rune, unfortunately, was trying to create an artifact and was not able to do so. So what we need to do, though, is we need to go down here to our crafts dwarf's workshop. The one that makes bolts is fine. And we are going to engrave memorial slab for blood rune. Alas, poor blood rune. We hardly knew you. Okay, goblins. They are not sieging us with very much vigor, I will say. And the episode is almost over, but that's my fault for being so long-winded. Oh, there we go. Uh-oh, the dog's in bad shape. Oh boy, there goes the dog. What's he doing? He's like partying. He's like dancing. What are you doing, jackass? See it here, the goblin, pikeman, zom, axu, mospe. The goblin pikeman stabs the stray dog in the head with her copper pike, tearing apart the muscle, bruising the skull. An artery has been opened by the attack. Alright, are they coming downstairs? Yep, here they come. Here they come, ladies and gentlemen. We have to tease them just enough. There we go. The bolts are flying. All right, now it's probably a good idea to close the drawbridge, huh? I want the one inner. Outer. Inner. Right? Inner drawbridge, tray drawbridge. Yes. All right, so I want this one, inner security gate. Probably should have pulled it sooner, actually. Hopefully this will not lead to untimely death. Doesn't look like it. In fact, it looks like we caught their leader in a trap. Oh, it's on now. It looks like we're running out of arrows. Or crossbows. There's our team. Yeah, refill, guys. Refill. Okay. So it looks like already we have... Is that Bumchafes? Bumchafes and Good Bad Dwarf have their little baby, Litast, with them. Because nothing says good parenting like bringing your baby to kill a bunch of goblins. As you can tell, it's taking quite a bit of effort to defeat them because we're using wooden bolts. But that's part of the plan, because the more times you fire, the better you get. What is all this noise going on? Oh. Alright, inaccessible items, that's fine. I don't care about that. So yeah, this is going to take a little bit of time, but now that my bolt situation is a lot better, they should be able to reload. Look, let's see if this guy reloads. See, he's reloading. Or no, he's not. He's running away, actually. Oh well, can't win them all. How about him? Reload? No, running away. You? No. Such brave fortress defenders I have. All right, he's out of arrows. Oh, he's refilling. No, he's not. Alright, well. Oh, they're coming back. They're coming back for more. More fun. That'll show these goblins. Anvilquested is protected. And we're not just killing them. We're killing them slow. Very, very slow. Tyrion Lannister's involved, the Zacks, Gordosh, Hank Luke, Atlas. Oh, I have to tell you guys, our first fortress kill was... Oh god, who was it? Someone punched a giant tick and it exploded. That was... Garai. So congratulations, Garai. You killed the first non-dwarven creature of this LP. You exploded a giant tick with your fist. And you're not even in the military. And there are still five of these guys, but two of them are in cages, so really it's just the three that are there that we need to worry about. Let's see how they're doing. Left lower arm, right lower leg. None of them are really, really badly hurt at all, actually. Well, no. His left hand is cut open. His left hand is bruised. His right hand is cut open. His right hand is bruised. His upper spine is bruised. His left cheek is cut open. All right, well. Better than nothing, I guess. Oh, well, one went down. I don't get that new sound. It's like, kuru, kuru, and I don't know what it means exactly. It sounds like a ghost or something, but I think it just means that they can't do their job. I don't like it. It wasn't there the last time I played. Wait, there are more than I thought. And the rest of the dwarves are idle and are throwing a party. Well, whatever. That's fine. These three down here are pumping away. Alright, folks. Well, I'm going to call an end to the episode right here. I'll pick up next episode where we left off, but it seems like this is going to take a little bit longer. The goblins are just going to die very slowly, but that's good, as I said, because it will train our men to be more effective Marks Dwarves. Our men and women, our brave men and women, the armed forces of Anvilquested, Bumshafe's bandits, and Gordosh's gorillas. So once again, I'm Marcus Aurelius. Thank you so much for watching. Have a good one.